for those that may eventually go back and rewatch this on video.
Or see one of the clips that they cut from it, yeah.
Congratulations on your championship. What was it like being in that locker room following
the
game?
Thank you very much. I'm still, like, you know, toweling off the champagne. You know, thank you, Adam Silver, for letting me in the bubble all this time. It's been tough flying back and forth.
Right.
No, well, whatever. I know you're making fun of me. You're I'm wearing a Lakers jersey.
It's
like a warm-up shirt. It's like you know what you would see the Lakers players wear, like, when they're warming up, when they're doing the layup drill.
Gotcha.
I'll tell you why. Like, I have a LeBron jersey too. Field, you saw me when I played with the Harlem Globetrotters. You remember that when I Matty Buckets, when I drilled the 20-footer against professional basketball players. Like, I'm not a jersey guy, right? I mean, I'm not a jersey guy, and just my body is built in a way, and by built in a way, I mean very doughy.
Stefania's got the best arms on this podcast.
Of course, exactly. Right. No, suns out, guns out. That means Stefania is on the show. So I'm not a jersey guy. I could have worn my LeBron jersey, but I decided not to. I decided to go with, this is what I used to wear all the time, because I am, and for people that don't know, that think I'm some Johnny come lately, that I'm some Johnny bandwagon guy.
Right, yeah.
I was a season ticket holder for the Lakers for 15 years when I lived out in Los Angeles before I came to work full time here at ESPN.
You were born in L.A., right?
I was not born in L.A. I moved there after college.
But your dad must have been a Lakers fan when he was a kid.
He was not.
Was not.
Your mom?
Nope.
Did you have a family friend or someone that was, like, close to the family?
No, when I moved out to L.A., when I moved out to L.A., I got season tickets for the Lakers when they used to play at the Forum and when their head coach was Del Harris. So before Phil Jackson, before Kobe and Shaq, like, this is legit. I don't want to hear, like,
legit. You're a Washington football team fan. We're not going to question you as a front runner with your allegiances.
Thank you very much. I was never a Washington Bullets fan growing up, but when I was out in L.A., I decided, oh, you know what? I should get tickets, and so I had, like, tickets up in the rafters. But I've been watching, you know, the games for a long, long, long time. I am. If anyone has followed me on social media over the years, they know that I am a longtime diehard, hardcore Lakers fan, and this is the first championship that I've not seen in person. Lakers. That's right. all the Kobe and Shaq ones, all the Kobe and Pau Gasol championships, I was there for every game in person. Had we were not in a worldwide pandemic, I would have paid whatever I had to pay, and I would have gotten to see all the games against the Miami Heat in person as well.
Can I borrow some money?
You know what? It just seems like with all that money you have to go.
It's not that I have all that money.
You could
have
got some socks to match your jersey and really gone with the wardrobe.
What's wrong with my socks? There's nothing wrong with my socks.
I mean, get some Lakers socks. Get some gold, purple.
I don't have gold purple socks. I should have. I didn't. You know what? That's the other thing with this.
If you were really a
set,
fan, I mean, I'm just saying.
If I was a real fan. Listen, Stefania Bell. I'm surprised you're not showing up in Lakers gear. You're such a bandwagon fan. Like, for the love of, Secret Squirrel.
I do want to know real quick before, we got a lot of football to talk about, but I do want to know this. Where were your season tickets at? Like, where in the arena were you around?
When the lowest I finally got was at the Staples Center after many, many years. I was on the corner, like where the team runs in and out of the stadium. So I was right there sort of on the elbow, lower bowl. Right there, I want to say section 118. I could be wrong on that, but it's been a few years, obviously, because I gave them up when I moved here.
Who was the closest celebrity there to your seats? Just curious. I'm just sort of trying to size up how good these tickets.
No. Like, there weren't any celebrities. What they were often what it was is that's where they put the opposing team's family. So it would always be like, hey, you know, like when they play the Celtics, like, hey, there's Kendrick Perkins' mom. Like, it would be stuff like that. Like, I mean, like,
you're not against Kendrick Perkins, huh?
I'm nothing against. I'm just saying, like, that's like, I remember one time, like, when we were playing the Celtics, like the Perkins family showed up in full force.
Right. Yeah.
And they are not quiet. They love their boy, no doubt. And so anyway, so it was like opposing family or wives or girlfriends or what have you of the team. And so that's sort of who was in that little section. But no, it was not
that's
asked a question there, and there's my socks. You know what? All you guys aren't champions, and I am. Screw you guys. I'm out of here.
Oh, literally. Matthew Berry. He's Matthew Berry. He's Matthew Berry.
By the way, go back and look at my Twitter feed. I predicted before the finals, Lakers in six, LeBron would be MVP. Thank you very much. Chef's kiss. There
Dude,
we go.
You had LeBron as MVP?
Massive limb you went out on.
Oh, my God.
Thank you very much.
Wow.
Amazing call.
Between
wow.
LeBron
no
as MVP, wait.
No one would have guessed that.
And
no
he had Patrick Mahomes as a top five quarterback
Stop
coming into the year.
Field.
Do you just retire right now?
I'm just saying. When you're hot, you're hot.
We got a ton of football to get to, so let's not
Whatever.
Spare any more
you guys
moments.
Can't ruin my you guys can't ruin my mood. You know why? Because we're the freaking world champions. Okay. We are champions of the world. And you guys still root for teams like the Detroit Lions.
Exactly. Oh,
that sounds very personal.
Didn't
right
let
there.
You down this weekend.
Let's get yeah. yeah, that's right. How did they do yesterday? They didn't lose, did they?
They did not lose.
Nope. Let's get
how
things rolling
football
here.
Football do this weekend.
We're still undefeated. Thank you very much.
All right, there
let's
you
keep
go.
Moving forward here with a bunch of news, and we're going to start briefly. Just a couple of COVID-19 updates. If you somehow you saw it, I'm sure you did. Yesterday, the Patriots and Broncos game was postponed. It was supposed to be played tonight, Monday, yep. 5 p.m. It's been pushed back to next week. There were a litany of schedule changes in total. 8 teams were impacted by the schedule changes the league announced. My best piece of advice to you, go to ESPN.com. We have already updated our schedule, and you can take a snapshot of it right now, but I'm going to offer this piece of advice. It probably is going to change again, maybe as soon as next week. So if you're going to write it down somewhere, like write it in pencil. Do yourself that favor. But we have one more that I think is more pertinent update, which is that...
Although I will say that I do think it is worth familiarizing yourself with it at least a little bit, because... I agree with you. It's going to change. It's going to change a lot of times between now and the end of the season, whenever that is. I mean, I think week 18 is certainly still in play, that they may have to add a week to the season. Having said that, though, it is worth being aware of bye weeks, because those are going to shift around, and you may have drafted or you may have constructed your roster in a certain way, thinking bye weeks are going to be one way, and all of a sudden now they're not. So I just do think it's going to be changing, and it's going to be something that you're going to have to pay attention to all season long, and we're going to help you out with that. But it is worth, I think, kind of taking a moment and being like, okay, what is my bye week situation coming up?
Fair enough. I agree on that point. The Bills and Titans game, though, has not been moved from Tuesday night. It is going to be played as scheduled as of right now. As of about an hour and a half ago, not only did the Patriots, but the Titans also received no new positive tests. And that's important, obviously, as if a positive test did pop up this morning or tomorrow morning, the Titans and Bills game would be moved. And one more note, because it's a really anticipated game, is the Chiefs-Bills game scheduled for Thursday has now been pushed back to next Monday at 5 p.m. Eastern time. One piece of strategy here. If you're wondering... No Thursday night game this week. If you're wondering, should I make an alteration to my lineup for the possibility that Titans-Bills game won't be played tomorrow night, it involves a Monday night football player from either the Chargers or the Saints... We're not going to learn about the next round of Titans PCR testing, which is the most accurate and reliable group of testing, until tomorrow morning. So right. It's not like you're going to find out today at 6 p.m., hey, the game's been pushed, and we're going to instead have the opportunity to make an informed decision. You're going to have to roll the dice as well. But things are trending in the right direction for the Titans and Bills to be played tomorrow night, 7 p.m. Eastern time. Assuming the game is played, you feel really good about Josh Allen and Derrick Henry, Stephon Diggs, and other stars from those two teams. We have a ton to get to from yesterday, but no moment was bigger, unfortunately, than what happened to Dak Prescott, the Dallas Cowboys star quarterback. And Stefania Bell, we're going to turn to you, because sometimes we see injuries, we don't know how bad they are. This was one where you kind of knew from the moment it took place something was seriously, seriously wrong.
Yeah, it was a scary moment and very, very emotional for Dak Prescott. But essentially, the nature of the injury, the team released a statement saying that he suffered a compound fracture and dislocated right ankle. And essentially it means it's an open fracture. So it punctures the skin. And as you may recall, we've talked about this before, those become emergency situations because you want to protect the wound. You want to get the individual to emergency care right away so that the wound can be cleaned and the injury can be addressed. And that's exactly what happened. So Dak Prescott was taken to a hospital. Dr. Gene Curry, a foot and ankle specialist, performed the surgery last night. There's been an update this morning that surgery went well. Dak is doing well, and they expect to release him later today. They've also issued a timetable of 4 to 6 months for him to recover. That sort of fits with what we know about these type of injuries. And the main thing is recovering from the initial wound. And then you go through a period of non-weight bearing, then gradually reintroduce weight. But it's down the road, 3 months maybe starting to run, 4 months maybe starting to do sport-specific activities, and then getting up to football. So the net-net of that is no return this year, but you're looking forward to next year. And I would just point out, we always look for comps. You look for players who've had similar injuries that have come back successfully. Kenyon Drake, running back in the NFL, who's doing very well. His junior year at Alabama, wow, suffered a fractured dislocation of his ankle. And when he was 2 years removed from that injury as a Miami Dolphin, he posted on Twitter that that injury made him what he was, that people thought he'd never make it to the NFL. And look at him now, and he thought it taught him a lot. So there's someone who's had a similar injury and recovered well for folks who are looking for encouraging news for Dak.
That is good to know, Stefania, and certainly not that Dak Prescott doesn't have enough motivation, but a good piece of inspiration there from one of his NFL brethren who has gone through a comparable injury. All right, it was
Dak Prescott. I don't know, man. Dak Prescott is, if you know anything about the man and sort of what he's gone through in his life, that is not a guy you bet against. That is not a guy you bet against. So, listen, you guys know me. I'm a diehard Washington fan. I hate the Cowboys, but love Dak. Love Dak as a person, and I think you saw it from the NFL, and you just saw so many players, so many competitors, prayers up for Dak because he's just that special of a person, and not that you would wish it on anyone, but just, listen, I have, you know, I have no concerns here. Just, I mean, I think if ever there was a guy to bet on, Dak Prescott is a guy to bet on.
Unquestionably a guy who certainly has, as you mentioned, the respect of people all over the NFL, not just his teammates and not just those that competed against him yesterday for the Giants. Twitter was abuzz with all sorts of support for Dak Prescott. And we don't want to make light of this injury in any way. We don't want to overlook the severity of it in any way. We are pressed with the challenge of trying to help people who have been riding the hot hand of Dak Prescott as a quarterback in fantasy football. And we're going to get into more waiver options tomorrow on the show, which is our normal Tuesday waiver wire show, because we'll have a bit more information and some context around the league that I think will be useful. But the initial thoughts in this Dak Prescott injury, Matthew, is that you might actually have the option to replace him on the roster in Andy Dalton. I mean, there was a reason why the team paid him a three-year guarantee plus $3 million guarantee with a chance to make $7 million in total. Yep. Dalton has been an accomplished player in his career with the Bengals previously, and he's in an excellent opportunity to step into a fantasy-relevant role.
I think he's the number one waiver pick, honestly, if you need a quarterback, right? Because, to your point, Andy Dalton's a good quarterback. Like, is he a great quarterback? No, he is not. But look, this is somebody who led the Bengals to the playoffs multiple years. This is somebody that has a top five fantasy finish on his career. Right? Yeah. This is somebody that was very fantasy relevant for a number of years in offenses in Cincinnati that were not nearly as fantasy friendly as Dallas's, and offenses that didn't have nearly the kind of talent that the Cowboys do with Amari Cooper and CeeDee Lamb and Michael Gallup and Dalton Schultz and obviously Ezekiel Elliott in the backfield. So it's an offense that we expect to continue to be high-flying and throwing a lot because I don't think their defense is improving anytime soon.
Right.
And so Andy Dalton, who, by the way, is also more mobile than he gets credit for. He is mobile in the way that sort of Dak Prescott is mobile. Like, I'm not saying he's Kyler Murray or Josh Allen or somebody like that or Lamar Jackson, but he is mobile in a Dak Prescott, Gardner Minshew sort of way in which he can get you 20 to 30 yards. Like that he is more mobile. If you go back and look at his numbers in Cincinnati, this is a guy that always would have like 3, 4, 5 rushing touchdowns a season. So I actually think that Andy Dalton, and I say this with truly respect, he is a professional NFL quarterback. Like, he is a very solid guy. He is better than some of the starters in the NFL right now. And now he comes into a situation here in Dallas where he's surrounded by a lot of skilled players and a fantasy-friendly offense. To me, I think if you were ranking from here till the end of the season, Andy Dalton would be a top 12 fantasy quarterback. You'd, for me at least, I'd prefer him to Matt Ryan the rest of the way. I'd prefer him to Carson Wentz the rest of the way. I think you can make a strong argument about him over Drew Brees the rest of the way. Like, I think he's right there in sort of that 8 to 12 range. Like, yeah, give me Andy Dalton, the starting quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys.
Certainly one of the names to consider. He'll be on the waiver wire tomorrow. I'm going to give you sort of four, maybe five quarterbacks, depending on your league, because it's not just Dak you're filling in for, but next week you've got Russell Wilson on a bye, and if you are still clinging to life with Drew Brees as your quarterback, then he would be replaced next week as well, because the Saints go on their bye. You know, Ryan Fitzpatrick, another name that we'll talk about a bunch tomorrow, but he has four straight games now of 20-plus fantasy points. I think we'll get into the fallout on this Cowboys offense, whether there is any throughout the rest of the week. But I think, as you said, like, Dalton's a professional quarterback. He's going to mostly keep this offense on the rails, and I think that these guys are so talented, too. Like, it's hard for me to imagine CeeDee Lamb, who looks like a star already.
Exactly.
You know, just sort of just free-falling to the point of irrelevance in fantasy. Amari Cooper had a bad day yesterday, obviously, but it's a Cooper special, right?
Right. And by the way, not just that, and by the way, that was James Bradbury. Like, give James Bradbury some credit. Like, Bradbury played well. And so, to the extent that you have Cowboys skilled players, I am not panicking or suddenly trying to get rid of Amari Cooper or CeeDee Lamb. Michael Gallup is a concern, but I don't think that's Andy Dalton related.
Yeah. So you mentioned earlier that the number one waiver ad of the week might be Andy Dalton. Maybe quarterback specific.
Quarterback specific, I should
say. We have another one that's brewing in Minnesota, Stefania, at just around or just before halftime, or maybe it was just after halftime, Dalvin Cook left the game for the Vikings. What happened there?
Yeah, he pulled up on a run. It was actually early in the third quarter and kind of reached for the inside of his thigh, telling you right away it was a groin injury. Went to the locker room, tried to come back. I think it was back for one play and then was essentially done. He is scheduled for an MRI today, so we hope to learn more.
Yeah, it was one of those weird ones because he left right away, went right back into the locker room. You're thinking to yourself, he's done for the day.
Of course.
Then he comes back out and is doing some cardio work on the side, and you're like, sideline, maybe this was crisis averted. Instead, it was not, as Stefania mentioned, just one play later. And
didn't look right on that one play.
He didn't look right, and that's exactly why he was taken out subsequently. And we don't ever want to see a player get injured. I would say, though, in terms of transitioning from a star running back to the next man up, there are few places where it is as seamless as it is in Minnesota because Dalvin Cook goes down and Alexander Mattison steps up, Matthew. He gets you 112 rushing yards. He adds 24 receiving yards. This would be the number one waiver ad of the week. And if this is a substantial injury for Dalvin Cook, and we'll see, then this could be the most valuable waiver pickup. I mean, it would be right in the conversation with Mike Davis based off what he's done in the 3 weeks without Christian McCaffrey.
That's exactly right. And you think about what Mike Davis has done. You think about what you just saw Alexander Mattison do in the second half against the Seahawks. And I would say, and by the way, it's not just those two guys, right? You think about what Latavius Murray did last year in the few games that Alvin Kamara missed, where he was a top five fantasy running back in those weeks. To me, this is just sort of like, this year more than ever, people are on different sides of this, whether you should draft insurance for your star running backs, right? And I've always been pro that person, because what happens is what you've seen a lot with Christian McCaffrey, right? A lot of people that had Christian McCaffrey were not able to acquire Mike Davis when that injury happened. And by the way, if you've had Dalvin Cook, you're probably doing pretty well because Dalvin Cook's been awesome. And if you don't have Alexander Mattison, chances are you're not getting him on waivers unless you use a fab system, you've been saving your money, and then you can outbid everyone. And so for me, there are a handful of running backs, Field, and we should talk about this tomorrow. There are a handful of running backs that I think are must-haves if you have that star player. Tony Pollard comes to mind. Latavius Murray, if you have Alvin Kamara, comes to mind.
Okay.
Right? I would argue Jamal Williams, if you have Aaron Jones, he comes to mind. So I think there are guys like that that are important to try to acquire now while they're quote-unquote cheaper versus, you know, and in some cases, actual free agents in your league versus waiting to, you know, hope they stay healthy and then something happens like this where all of a sudden now, you know, you have Dalvin Cook and you've been flying high. And listen, we hope for the best with Dalvin Cook, but if this is going to be an injury that keeps him out for an extended period of time, your season suddenly just got derailed.
And I think if Cook misses time, I expect that Mattison cracks the top 10 or 12 in our weekly rankings until Dalvin Cook returns. Stefania, a weird one. I'm not quite sure. Is Jimmy Garoppolo banged up, or was this a bench based off performance situation?
Well, Kyle Shanahan said that he could tell that Jimmy Garoppolo was dealing with lingering effects of that high ankle sprain. Remember, yesterday was the first time that he had played since injuring his ankle in week two. And he didn't look right. I mean, if anybody was watching the game, he clearly didn't look right. And we had been talking in fantasy football now about how he's not a particularly mobile quarterback. So I think people may have assumed, well, then it shouldn't affect him. But he still has to be mobile enough to escape pressure, to hand off, to pivot, turn, and to plant and throw. And he wasn't right. And Kyle Shanahan saw that, knew that they were down. They'd have to pass a lot in the second half. So he said he opted to go with C.J. Beathard. who knows what's going to happen this week, but he's obviously going to have to prove that he's healthier before there's even discussion about him coming back to start.
Yeah, it will be really interesting. Again, the 49ers have been no strangers to injuries this season, sadly.
Been awful.
But Matthew, you know, like, I don't know. So yesterday, Kendrick Bourne finds the end zone. Deebo Samuel is still getting there, but he's playing more. Strikes me as a nice invest low player.
I agree.
But is there anybody that you really, like, does Jimmy Garoppolo's presence or absence really move the needle for any 49ers pass catcher? It doesn't really for me.
No, it doesn't either for me as well. I mean, to Stefania's point, I mean, like, Garoppolo looked like he was missing players, wide open players, by like 5 yards. Like he looked bad in every aspect of the game. And by the way, credit to the Miami Dolphins, who came out there and just, you know, lay a smackdown on the Niners and did sort of what, Stefania, what the Lakers did to the Miami Heat.
Wow.
You know,
I was waiting.
Very simple.
This was
very
coming.
Simple.
Come on.
Like that, you know,
come
on. Just, I mean, it was just kind of like, just, you know, just basically said, we're going to win this game. We're taking no prisoners.
Yep.
That's and, what the Lions did to the
bye week.
They
look bad. They look bad.
They
look
bad. And the Dolphins were Laker-esque yesterday. Yeah. It got away from them. Like, Raheem Mostert looked great. But, you know, he had, like, I think he had 90 yards, but, like, on 11 touches. So it was just one of those things where I just think the game got away from him. Kittle didn't really do much, and you would expect that to happen. I'm not worried about, to the extent that you have a 49ers player, whether it's Raheem Mostert, whether it is George Kittle, I agree with you on Deebo Samuel. Listen, I think maybe, temper expectations here on Brandon Ayuk now that the pass catchers, I think he's a talented player,
right.
But in terms of consistent fantasy value, if Kittle and Deebo Samuel are healthy along with a healthy run game, right? And you are going to have the Kendrick Bournes of the world out there still.
Right. I think that's more the other pass catchers dependent, quarterback, but
correct. I don't think this is an injury where we suddenly have to do a lot of analysis on the other 49ers players. I think whether it's Bethard, whether it's Garoppolo, whether it's Nick Mullins, they're all sort of about the same.
Stefania, we need good news in 2020. There hasn't been a ton of it. And you're going to be on Outside the Lines for those that are watching this live or listening to it early at 1:45 p.m. today with Jeremy Schapp. There's a very good reason why. Enlighten us.
Well, Project 11, Alex Smith returned to the field yesterday. And you never like to see it happen because somebody else got injured. But essentially, that is what happened. You know, Alex came in as the number two. They made some switches in the depth chart at quarterback. Kyle Allen was the starter. And he looked pretty good, actually, out of the gate. Then suffered a blow and was taken to the locker room for evaluation. And Alex's number was called and he returned to the field, and it was really something special to see. I think everyone who saw it and witnessed it felt the same way. And it was really, for me, it was amazing to see this after following his journey for close to 2 years and then seeing his wife and family in the stands on a day that they only allowed family members into the stadium. To have his family there, I think that those were the most important people there. And you know what's really interesting, guys, is this was eerily similar to the conditions on the day he injured himself. So it was FedEx Field. It was pouring rain when he was out there. It was sloppy and wet. And he had a big, scary pass rusher coming at him. You know, it was J.J. Watt that tackled him when he suffered the injury. And the first contact he took was a whole lot of Aaron Donald on his back, and he survived it. I mean, he got sacked 5 or 6 times over the course of the second half, and not that anybody wanted to see that, but if you ever wanted to test how he'd respond to everything that could set up the stress of the injury circumstances that happened to him, I think you saw that, you know, he held up pretty well. So it was really a wonderful thing to see.
Stefania, if people have not seen Project 11 yet, and I cannot recommend it highly enough. You did great work. The access you got to Alex and the Smith family and his doctors and seeing the journey, it's really incredible. How can people watch it now? I assume it is still on demand, that you can still watch Project 11.
Yes, it's on ESPN Plus, and you can search for Project 11 there.
There you go. Great. So I highly recommend it. Cannot tell you enough. I agree with you, Stefan. It was so... here's what I tweeted out. Especially, by the way, if you watch Project 11, like, and you see what he was this close to getting it amputated. You know what I mean? And so what Alex Smith, like, a lot of people were like, this guy's never going to walk again. So the fact that this guy took a snap in an NFL game after what he went through is unbelievable. This is what I tweeted yesterday, Field. is like he should be comeback player of the year and they should name the award after him. Like I don't think people grasp. Stefania obviously does, but I just don't think generally people grasp what Alex Smith accomplished by getting on the field yesterday, completing a pass, by like, you know, getting hit and you know, playing quarterback in the NFL. The offensive line did him no favors. The Washington offense did him no favors, but Alex Smith is a warrior, man, and so it was just an awesome, awesome sight to see.
I don't want to suggest that Dak Prescott's injury will be as grave to recover from as Alex Smith was, but Alex Smith certainly is motivation for Dak Prescott, two quarterbacks that you can imagine have a lot of respect for each other for what they've already been through in their careers and their lives, and what I think Dak has ahead of him. Alex Smith would be a tremendous person to model his comeback after. All right, Stefania, we do have some other quick hitter injury updates here, and then one that's like sort of an injury update, but actually not as much as you might think. But let's begin in Pittsburgh. Deontay Johnson goes down yesterday, and what happens?
It was weird. Like, he disappeared before I even really knew what happened, but Mike Tomlin later said that he took a direct blow to his back, and that was the reason that he was out. But Tomlin did say that he thought he'd be fine for next week, so that's encouraging.
Yeah, unfortunately for the Steelers, they weren't able to find a way to get anything out of their receiver after.
I know. I mean, look, somebody could have chosen that person as a long shot.
Right. Someone also could have not traded Chase Claypool in the war room.
I mean, it's unbelievable. So first off, so I do my long shots on fantasy football now, and it literally for me it was between Chase Claypool and Trey Burton. Of course, I went with Trey Burton. Good job, Barry. He did. He actually had five catches. Like he was
but
better than Mo
Alie-Cox
or Jack Doyle, but he didn't have three touchdowns or four touchdowns.
Four,
I mean,
yeah.
He didn't have four touchdowns. But your track record field in the War Room League is unbelievable. You and our producer, Matt Harrington, co-manage a team, the Irish Twins, and you have famously over the years, you know, I believe you, not to pour salt in the wounds, because you're a very good fantasy manager, but, right, you know, whether it was trading away Amari Cooper, and then he has that monster game on Thursday night.
Yeah, that was a Wednesday trade. Yeah,
right, I believe you traded away Aaron Jones.
Yeah, that
and then
worked.
He had the four-touchdown game after, like, I think this was last year.
Yeah, that was last year.
Last year. Mm. And then this week you did what looked like at the time a minor trade. You traded away Chase Claypool to get Darius Slayton, who, by the way, had a very nice game.
It's like, and also, we're the highest scoring team in the league this week by over 35 points.
Yeah, like, you guys crushed this
it's
week.
It's like, it's hilarious that this happens, right? But such is life in
such
fantasy football. We'll talk about Claypool more today, and then also later tomorrow on the Waiver Wire column show. Stefania, the Chiefs.
But what a disappointing season for Deontay Johnson so far, because we've had so much.
Well, injury-wise, he had two games.
Of course.
Yeah, I was going to say, I thought you were saying, like, he was good the first 2 weeks of the season when he was
healthy.
He's
an unbelievable talent, but then now the emergence of Chase Claypool, like, it. Anyway,
we'll get into that more tomorrow. And Stefania, Sammy Watkins left the game for the Chiefs as well.
Yeah, another soft tissue injury for Sammy Watkins, a hamstring issue that forced him out of the game. Obviously, stay tuned. He's no stranger to these type of injuries, but you know, what can you say? There's not really much else left to say about Sammy Watkins.
Yeah, what you can say is, you know, Mecole Hardman should be on your waiver wire ad.
Maybe,
this week.
But he was like fourth in routes run yesterday.
I know, but yeah. I think without Sammy Watkins there, I do think he suddenly gets.
We've seen
more
this
run.
Though a lot, right? Like, we've seen this before, and it feels like it's.
You
it
some DeMarcus Robinson,
DeMarcus
and
Robinson.
Byron Pringle, and
like, exactly.
Plus, until you know the severity of it, you know, is it a 1 to 2 week injury or is it something more significant? That's what you're always.
AJ Green also left the game yesterday. Stefania,
yeah, I know,
season.
And this is right after I made that call on the show yesterday. Like, watch what he does in the second half, and this one made me personally really sad because this guy has worked so hard to overcome a couple major injuries. I mean, the first one was that toe surgery, comes back from that, and it's like the first day of camp, and he has that ankle injury that then ultimately costs him all of last season. There's no one who works harder, maybe Alex Smith, but nobody else who works harder in their rehab and dedicates himself to coming back. And he is a guy who suffered a torn hamstring. Don't know if you guys remember that injury.
Sure. Yeah.
And that took him out for, I think, the final six or seven games of that season. Came back, and I was really worried about how it would hold up. Has not been a problem until this year, if you recall. Preseason, little bit of noise about hamstring, but he downplayed it. Didn't seem to bother him the first few weeks. He just didn't look like himself overall. Maybe rustiness, maybe not, you know, a step slow. But now, hamstring injury, done for the game. We'll see what happens. But all of it, compounded the way he looked to start the year just doesn't make me feel great.
Yeah, I'm with you. And Matthew, I think probably the only question here is, can you drop AJ Green?
Yes.
Okay, welcome to Dump Steal for AJ Green. It's been a tough, tough go of it for him. And T. Higgins is playing more, and he's playing well. He's got...
I know the waiver wire column come out later today. I assume T. Higgins is on it.
Yep.
Should be.
At least six targets in four straight games for T. Higgins. And the last one here, Stefania, is Michael Thomas was not really a question mark because of the ankle injury tonight. But now all of a sudden we have some clarity.
But he was yesterday. Remember, he was like one of our biggest topics on the Sunday show was he was coming in questionable. And he had had two straight weeks of limited practice. And remember, Adam came on, who has him in the War Room League, Adam Schefter, and said even he didn't know. He was getting conflicting reports. And now we sort of understand why. But the reason it's important from an injury standpoint is my feeling all along had been that he'd done enough that they were willing to put him out there this week. Even though there was a bye next week, I felt pretty good that we were going to see him be able to take the field. Then ultimately, we find out yesterday that he is ruled out for a disciplinary issue and not going to play on Monday night. So regardless of how healthy he is not playing tonight.
This is absolutely insane. But think about this. They have a bye next week. Michael Thomas will have 4.2 total fantasy points for the season. 12 receiving yards going to week 7. I'm sure, like, listen, of course he has bounce back potential. He could be the number one wide receiver in fantasy from week 7 on. I'm not doubting that. But if you draft Michael Thomas, you're probably in a major rut, Matthew.
Sure.
And you can't do this today because obviously they play tonight and everybody else has already played. But you wake up Wednesday morning after the Tuesday night game is done. Are you doing everything in your power to trade away Michael Thomas to get something in return? Because if you have him, you're probably not going to be 5-0 after this week.
No, probably not. And listen, if you're in that situation, if you're 5-0 or 4-1, even 3-2, you know, but feeling good about your team, and then now you're getting Michael Thomas back, like, you're feeling pretty good about yourself. My feeling, though, is that, you know, and I think, you know, you always do those trade things. Like, Michael Thomas is one of those guys that's always been traded a lot so far this year in ESPN. My guess is that he's already sort of been dealt by, you know, the manager that has him in your league. If they got off to a slow start, they may have already traded him, like, you know, after 3 weeks or what have you. But, yeah, if somebody is willing to still give you, you know, first-round value, top 15 value for Michael Thomas based on the potential, hey, he's going to come back starting week 7, I would take it because the Saints offense doesn't look right. And it's fair to, you know, listen, it's fair to say, like, hey, that's not cool because the offense doesn't look right because they don't have Michael Thomas. You know what I mean? Like, I understand, like, it's hard to judge them without Michael Thomas, hard to judge Drew Brees without Michael Thomas, but just doesn't look great. And does he come back slow a little bit? I don't know. If somebody was willing to give me a top 15 player for Michael Thomas, I would take it right now.
Here's a wild trade, just because I know how fantasy football works.
Sure.
It's not going to be like, yeah, you can trade Michael Thomas and get DeAndre Hopkins in return. That's not the trade you're going to make.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you had Michael Thomas, someone offered you Robbie Anderson right now, would you do it?
I can't believe I'm saying this, but I think I would.
Isn't that crazy? I mean, I probably wouldn't. I'd have to think long and hard about it, which is a ridiculous thought that we're having that conversation. But he was the first player that came to mind that's been riding hot and looks like a legit part of their offense every week.
Absolutely.
And it's like, you know, you've got 5 weeks of production from Robbie Anderson. It's insane.
And you're going to have next week. Like, I mean,
right.
That's the other thing.
Because
like, if you're sitting there at 1-4 or 2-3, like, you need a win. You know what I mean? And, like, Michael Thomas ain't going to help you, you know, like, fine, you get it back in week 7, but you're 0-6, you're 1-5, like,
I know, it's crazy.
Whatever.
It's crazy.
So
yeah.
You have to take that into the equation
All
here.
All bets are off, baby.
You may be getting, you're getting into got to start winning, you know, right now. It's getting late early, as they say. So that's a close one to me, but just, you know, like, don't you feel a little kind of bad vibes around Michael Thomas?
It's weird. But I also am like totally, I'm always fearful of the, he comes back revenge tour week 7 on and he has 100 catches in the
Which
final 10 games.
Which easily could happen. I mean, he's insanely talented.
Yeah.
So the point is that, yes, a trade that would have seemed insane 5 weeks ago, you know, you'd at least consider it. If you had Michael Thomas and somebody, and you were sitting there like 1-4, 2-3, whatever, 0-5, and somebody offered you Robbie Anderson, you'd at least think about it. And that's a crazy thing to think about, you know, now.
Running back backfield's coming up. Running back workload splits, I suppose, coming up. But first, whatever you want to protect, nobody has more ways to help keep you safe than ADT. You can customize an ADT security package to help protect your home in a way that works for you and your budget. Whether you want just the basics or all the bells and whistles, ADT can work with you to customize a system to help protect your home. HD video doorbells, indoor and outdoor cameras, smart lights, smart locks, smart thermostats, flood sensors, and fire and carbon monoxide detectors that are connected to 24/7 monitoring, all controlled by the sound of your voice or the ADT app. All ADT products are rigorously tested to deliver the quality you expect from ADT, the most trusted name in security. ADT expert installers average 10 plus years of experience, and we want you to be happy with their ADT service. That's why we provide one of the best money-back guarantees from a national security provider. Protect now, pay later with low, flexible monthly payments to help fit your budget.
Do you ever feel like you're always on?
Mm-hmm.
These days, everything is go, go, go. I mean, it's nothing but nonstop hustle all the time, and everyone knows nothing good comes from hustling. Work, friends, family, a million pressing social issues, and an expectation to be on 24/7. Sometimes you just need a moment to turn off and hit reset. That's when you reach for a Coors Light. It's made to chill. There's only one beer out there that's literally made to chill. Coors Light. Mm-hmm. Watching football is therapeutic to fans. It is an uninterrupted me time and an excuse to chill and drink beer. And Coors Light is the official beer of watching any sport or team just to drink beer. Mountain cold refreshment, made to chill. Coors Light is cold lagered, cold filtered, and cold packaged. It's literally made to chill and celebrate with responsibly. It's as crisp and refreshing as the Colorado Rockies, a perfect moment to unwind. Coors Light is the beer to choose when you need to unwind, so when you want to hit reset, reach for the beer that's made to chill. Get Coors Light in the new look delivered straight to your door at get.coorslight.com. Coors Brewing Company, Golden, Colorado. And please, don't forget to celebrate responsibly.
All right, so let's get into some running back splits. And, you know, I don't want to have this conversation about the Rams backfield every week. I don't want to every week say, hey, do we have some clarity?
Have you chosen the wrong profession? I've been like, man, oh, man.
Before you guys dive into it, let me just say this. We all know, as far as Cam Akers goes, you know he was coming off that rib cartilage injury. And Sean McVay said after the game that he planned to increase his workload next week.
Oh, perfect.
That part of it was just to add to the mix of what you'd like to discuss, that part of it was an injury concern with Akers coming off that injury.
Yeah, so that's exactly my point, is that, hey, so you may be sitting here saying to yourself, like, oh, we can definitely trust Daryl Henderson, who had a decent day yesterday. I mean, he had more than a decent day. He had 22 fantasy points because he scored twice, once through the air and once on the ground as well. But he played four more snaps than Malcolm Brown, and now Cam Akers is going to potentially have a more legitimate role going forward. I think Daryl Henderson is a great sell-high candidate.
Yeah, I don't mind that, although I do think Daryl Henderson has value the rest of the year. Maybe not the value that he had Sunday or that he's had through the first, whatever we are. We're week five, right?
Yeah.
Through the first 5 weeks, right? Because he's been really good for three of the 5 weeks. He's been really good.
So I think, he's a sell high then.
So, yeah. But play that out for a second, okay?
What
do you think you could get for Daryl Henderson right now? Because assuming... most fantasy managers, I think, are somewhat smart.
Mm-hmm.
And so, assuming you play in a league where people know what they're doing.
What if I offered you Kenyon Drake?
I have Daryl Henderson in the War Room League.
Okay. If I have Kenyon Drake?
I prefer Daryl Henderson.
Interesting. Okay.
I'm Team Chase Edmonds. I'm Team Chase Edmonds.
How about David Johnson?
That's about the right range.
Okay.
I'd have to really think about that. Yeah, I mean, yeah, probably.
How about Melvin Gordon?
I'm not a Melvin Gordon fan. But, yeah, I mean, yeah, probably take Melvin Gordon just because of the guaranteed workload.
These are the kind of players that I think you could reasonably fetch right now for Daryl Henderson, right?
Yeah.
I mean, guys, that's the point I'm making, is that, like, you've got three guys who, as of right now, are still dominant workhorses for their backfield.
Yeah.
I understand that Chase Edmonds has played a little bit more, but still, and we'll talk about that in about 30 seconds. But I think he's a sell-high candidate, in my opinion.
Yeah, no, I don't mind that. I'm just not convinced you're going to be able to get I'm just not convinced somebody that has Melvin Gordon or David Johnson is going to give that player up for Daryl Henderson, who is in this committee. And you sit there and you look at the box score and you say, oh, Cam Akers, 9 for 61. Now, a lot of that came late when they were up big and just sort of grinding it out and trying to get Akers some run. But whatever, like, Cam Akers looked like that. And coming into the season, Cam Akers was the guy that everyone sort of was targeting in drafts. So I'm just saying, like, you, it depends on what you're offered, obviously.
Yeah.
But there is certainly a scenario field where what you're offered for Daryl Henderson isn't as great as the upside of Daryl Henderson, who, regardless of either if Cam Akers gets an increased workload, Daryl Henderson is still an explosive running back who is still going to be part of this backfield. And so knowing when to start him is going to be a bit of a challenge. So, yes, if you could get, you know, if Melvin Gordon, I'm definitely doing. If you could get David Johnson, yeah, probably. But I'm not sure you're even going to get that quality of running back. It is definitely worth exploring, though. I agree with you. Probably, you know, best to explore it now if you are going to trade Daryl Henderson.
I just mentioned the Cardinals backfield, so let's sort of vet that out a little bit more. As Kenyon Drake played 46 snaps yesterday to 27 for Chase Edmonds. Edmonds is available at 55% of leagues. He'll make the waiver column. So I think there's two questions here.
Yep.
Which back is more talented? I think the answer, there's a debate there, right? It's a debate. I mean, I know last week I sort of poo-pooed it.
I prefer Chase Edmonds, but there's a debate.
I think Kenyon Drake is still the more talented back, but okay. I think it's at least a conversation, right? Based off how they're playing right now. Right now, I should say. Right now, he is playing better than Kenyon Drake is. Yep. I want to be consistent and say I do believe Kenyon Drake is a more talented player overall.
Fair enough.
But also the usage, right? Because Cliff Kingsbury said, I think, going into week five, like, our job over the next 12 games is to find a way to get Kenyon Drake the ball a lot more. And yesterday, he got the ball plenty. He had 18 rushing yards, but it's not 18 rushing attempts.
Sure.
But I don't care about those. I care about the receiving. And he had one target yesterday, one catch on one target. Again, that brings his total to 6 targets through 5 games. That is absurd.
Chase Edmonds is their passing down back. Go back and look at my love-hate from last week. And Chase Edmonds, not Kenyon Drake, Chase Edmonds was my others receiving votes. Mm. Because I was just like, listen, he's their passing down back. And what happened in this game, he got 6 targets, right? 6 targets for 56 yards. And 5 receptions on those 6 targets. So the fact is then going back to our conversation earlier in the show, you know, when we're talking about Alexander Mattison, we're talking about Mike Davis, and we're talking about guys like Tony Pollard or Latavius Murray or guys that you need. Latavius Murray is probably rostered, but, you know, Jamal Williams, that kind of, like, Chase Edmonds on that list. Because if anything were to happen to Kenyon Drake, Chase Edmonds would be, to me, a top 10, top 12 fantasy running back. He would be awesome. He's clearly playing better than Kenyon Drake right now. I prefer him talent-wise as well. But just to your point, the problem with Drake has not been volume. He's gotten 91 touches on the year. Chase Edmonds only has 37. So he's literally out-touching Chase Edmonds 3-1, basically. You know, a little bit less than 3-1. And yet, despite out-touching him almost 3-1, Kenyon Drake, 51.6 fantasy points. Chase Edmonds, 58.4.
Yeah.
Like, Chase Edmonds has been the better fantasy backfield through 5 weeks. But
this is a classic fantasy conundrum. It seems evident, and it seems inevitable that Kenyon Drake will still continue to get a decided edge in terms of overall snaps played and overall number of touches. Chase Edmonds will just be far more efficient and could end up being within, let's say, 20% of Kenyon Drake's overall fantasy points this year, which makes things nothing more than maddening. I think the coaching point here is to make sure that Chase Edmonds is rostered in your league.
Yeah, I mean, if you watch the fantasy show on ESPN Plus, I'll get it a plug in here, but like Secret Squirrel and I talked about Chase Edmonds on the fantasy show on ESPN
Plus. Good call by you.
Last week, and we've talked about him throughout the year, but basically we said, you know, hey, he was high on our running back waiver list last week as well.
No, you were on that. You were on that for sure.
He is somebody that is a must add, especially if you don't have a need right now.
Somebody who is a must start is Raheem Mostert, who you mentioned earlier on in the show, Matthew. Raheem Mostert. Must start.
Someone who's a must start.
I said someone who's a must start is Raheem Mostert. I thought I had accounted for it. Nope. But anyways, I just want to quickly give you the breakdown yesterday as I think we learned when he's playing, he's definitely, unquestionably, the workhorse back for San Francisco. 31 snaps yesterday, just 14 for Jerick McKinnon. And so 11 rushes for 90 yards for Raheem Mostert, 3 receptions for 29 yards. The 49ers offense is far from a thing of beauty right now, but he's playing like one of the best backs in football. On a per-touch basis, Raheem Mostert has been absolutely brilliant. I think if we learned something yesterday, it might be that, like, when he's playing, there's not a lot of value for anybody else in that backfield.
That's right. I mean, that's the big thing right there, is McKinnon just did absolutely nothing yesterday. And what's weird is McKinnon is considered, quote unquote, the passing down back.
Yeah.
And in a game in which the 49ers trailed like almost the entire game, Stefania, I mean, you saw how badly they were getting beaten. I mean, like, it was just like it wasn't close from moment one.
I actually walked away the first half, but I do want to say something about Mostert.
Can you give us an impression of how you walked away in the first half? Just a quick impression.
No.
Go ahead.
It wasn't.
Because she was like, no. She flipped her hair and she was like disgusted. She rolled her eyes.
Yeah.
It's very funny.
Threw my bag over my shoulder.
Yeah, she did.
Yeah.
She was out.
No, listen.
What?
Raheem Mostert was coming off an MCL injury. And remember, at the start of the week, Kyle Shanahan didn't think he was going to play. And so I was very concerned about starting him yesterday in fantasy. In fact, I have him in a number of leagues and I chose not to play him given the fact that he had done very little. It was an MCL sprain, which is tough for a running back to come back from. And they really didn't decide until Sunday morning. I mean, they were feeling pretty good Friday that he had a chance, but then it was coming down to how he felt on Sunday. So if he could do that much and be the predominant running back on a day where they didn't expect to have him and you thought they were maybe going to use him less, imagine what he will be as he gets healthier.
I mean, that was what's interesting here, right? To Stefania's point, right? I mean, you think about Mostert and you think, okay, here's a guy with power. Here's a guy with speed. And oh, by the way, they're using him in the passing game field. I mean, so yesterday, Jerick McKinnon, again, in a game in which they were trailing, and Mostert's coming off this injury, so quote unquote, they want to limit his touches. In a game in which they were trailing almost the entire time, Jerick McKinnon, 2 receptions on 4 targets. Raheem Mostert, 3 receptions on 3 targets. I mean, yeah, you know, Jeff Wilson Jr. got a couple of touches in there, but like Raheem Mostert was the guy. And, you know, you think back earlier to the season, like one of the big plays was just like a little swing pass that Raheem Mostert took the distance. I think he's a special player. I think the 49ers really found something with him that we saw it last year towards, you know, on their Super Bowl run. And it's picked up right where it left off. There was a reason why we were so high on him coming into the season.
They're going to need him as their schedule upcoming is very daunting. Just to reiterate something that we talked about last week, and I just think we got further evidence of it. The Ravens' backfield is completely and utterly useless in fantasy football right now. Just for those that did not watch the game or see how it all played out, yesterday Gus Edwards had 24 snaps. Mark Ingram had 19. J.K. Dobbins had 18. J.K. Dobbins had 4 total touches. Mark Ingram had 11 rushes for 57 yards. Gus Edwards had 7 for 25. I saw this note somewhere, and I got to see where it was. But Lamar Jackson has even been far from, like, he is, what I don't know where he is on terms of points per game basis amongst quarterbacks, but he ain't close to where you drafted him to be.
Absolutely
this
not.
Offense, maybe they're 4-1, and they waxed the Bengals yesterday, but that game was much closer than it should have been for, like, 3 quarters. Like, the fact that it was 17-0 for as long as it was yesterday, the Ravens offense is in a little bit of a funk right now. A little bit.
I have to tell you, like, if it wasn't for, like, Kenyon Drake, if it wasn't for a couple other big name guys, right, there's an argument to be made that Lamar Jackson is one of the biggest busts in fantasy football so far year, right? Because to draft Lamar Jackson, and he's been fine, but to draft Lamar Jackson where you drafted him, and he went like in the first round in some leagues and certainly in the second. You and I both had him as a third rounder. But we talked about this. So we were like, wait on quarterback, because the argument for taking Lamar Jackson high is that not only is he going to finish as the number one quarterback in fantasy, but he's going to finish as the number one quarterback in fantasy much, you know, by a significant margin, which is what he did last year.
Yeah.
Right. And not only has he not been the number one quarterback in fantasy, right? I mean, he's been fine.
Oh, you know what he is, by the way?
What is he?
He's quarterback 15 in points per game.
I mean, I'm right. Quarterback 15. I mean, that's what you're dealing with here with Lamar Jackson. And by the way, this is a home game against the Bengals. Yeah. If ever there was a game for Lamar Jackson to be
sloppy,
Lamar, it was wet and I get that, but whatever.
Yeah.
Like, Lamar Jackson should have gone off in this game field and he didn't.
He's averaging fewer fantasy points than Jared Goff.
I mean,
Anyways, we don't have to. Still have to start him, and we get all that part. But let's keep an eye on this Ravens backfield and see if they can find some magic later. We have a couple more top.
I had to real quickly just to finish up on that point. Like, I'm in a 10-team league where, like, I had some roster issues because of injuries and, you know, everything that's going on with COVID, and so, like, I was just like, I don't want to do it. But you know what? Like, I have to drop J.K. Dobbins. I hope I don't come to regret this. Like, so far, 1 week in, like. Nope. I don't know that you can.
It's weird. J.K.
Dobbins has insane upside, But unless something happens to Ingram and potentially Gus Edwards, like I just don't see it.
We got to move forward here, and I want to get to one injury update, and then I want to play like a little game of like almost like a blind resume, but we speak it out loud. Okay. Stefania, Le'Veon Bell returned to lineup yesterday, and did you see anything that gave you concern about was it the hamstring he was dealing with prior to week 5? How did you feel about his performance yesterday and his overall health assessment?
Well, you know, he didn't leave the game.
That's good.
these are accomplishments. Yeah. And I didn't, to be honest, like, this is one where I want to go back and watch the snaps and really see if I see anything that jumps out at me. But what I did see, nothing remarkable, nothing that would really sway me in the direction of like, oh, wow, hey, Le'Veon Bell looks like Le'Veon Bell used to. But by the same token, when you're out, you've barely played it all this season, no preseason action, I suppose you have to be happy with the fact that he did not leave the game with an injury.
He played 45 snaps to Frank Gore's 19. Here's the problem, though. He had one catch on one target for 7 yards. He had 7.7 fantasy points. The days of Le'Veon Bell's elite fantasy usage, they're over.
Far Bye-bye. Gone. Like, he's barely a flex play. And here's his upcoming schedule. At Miami, home to Buffalo, at Kansas City, home to New England.
What's the line going to be in that Jets-Kansas City game? 16.5
Right,
at Kansas City?
Like, where do you feel good? If he's not going to be involved in the passing game,
yeah.
Where do you feel good about starting him? By the way, Miami's suddenly a lot tougher than we give him credit for. Like, Brian Flores has him playing well. Good for that franchise. You certainly don't like him against Buffalo. At Kansas City, listen, I know Kansas City got decimated yesterday. Like, they just
you like them? I know when you like them. But when there are 6 teams on a bye, when you like them.
Yeah, I guess.
That's probably it.
You don't like them. You can tolerate them. When there are 6 teams on a bye, you tolerate them.
Probably true. All right. So I got to tell you. So almost like a blind resume here. There's a player who has at least 7 catches, at least 10 targets, and at least 100 receiving yards in all 3 games he's played this season. He's got at least a 35-yard reception in each of those 3 games. He's finished inside the top 20 in his position, which is wide receiver, in every game this season. Care to venture a guess who it is? Unless you've already started the note.
In all 3 games. Like, I mean, there's a couple of guys that Robbie Anderson comes to mind, right? DK Metcalf comes to mind in terms of...
How about this? Because we're short on time. It's Jamison Crowder. Good news of the day is Jamison Crowder. And I'm saying this right now, and I don't think this is an original thought, so I don't want to make it come across as that, but let me echo what others have said. He's the most underappreciated player in fantasy football this season.
Yep.
Jamison Crowder has been a top 20 wide receiver in each of the 3 games in which he has played. And I don't care if it's ugly with this Jets offense. He has done it with Joe Flacco and Sam Darnold, but he's been unbelievable. I mean, that is ridiculous production in each of these 3 weeks. So if you've got Jamison Crowder on your roster, you dealt with the 2 games that he missed because of injury. But the Jets are not fun to watch weekly. Jamison Crowder might be the only reason why they're fun to watch weekly right now, because that dude is just churning out fantasy points. What more do we need to see before he's a lineup lock?
Yeah, absolutely nothing. I think this goes for just about anything in life. If you can do it with Joe Flacco, you can do it anywhere.
That's a really sound analysis.
There you go. I'm just saying, just in general, just in life. That's just good life advice. It's fantasy points, and it's just pretty much everything else.
So, again, he's underappreciated. I feel like he's one of those players that I need to re-trigger my thoughts about where I rank him each week, because he's not someone that I have inside my top 15 consistently. It may
not
be
sexy.
That we need, but you may need to have Jamison Crowder somewhere inside your top 20 every single week for wide receivers until given reason to believe otherwise.
Former Washington professional football player.
That's right. How do you banish high rates on car insurance?
How, Field?
You switch to Geico during Geicoween, bruh.
Oh, come on, buddy.
I love making that sound so much. Should I do it again?
From your belly.
Bruh.
Feel the hate.
October is Geico's favorite time of year. Geico has been working even harder to cast out high rates on car insurance and craft just the right coverage for you and your family. But here's one thing you may not know about Geico. They could also help you uncover more ways to save on the other things parked in your driveway, like your beloved motorcycle, boat, or even your home away from home, your RV. Geico could even help you save on homeowners and renters insurance. So visit geico.com today and you'll see firsthand that switching your insurance coverage does not have to be scary. The only thing that will haunt your nightmares is seeing just how much you could have saved if you had switched sooner. Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Happy Geico-ween, everybody.
Sport Clips Haircuts has made your experience even better with OnDeck text alerts. which means less wait time and more prime time. You'll get a 15-minute heads up when it's time to head in and another text alert when you're next in line. Sport Clips is giving you more ways to save. So now you can enjoy your prime time. Sport Clips haircuts. It's good to be a guy.
All right, here's what I'm going to do. Rapid fire here because we only have a few minutes left. And we talked about some players that had a chance to rebound. And I'm going to give you the stats. And Matthew, you give me a number, 1 to 10, how panicked you are. We'll get into more thoughts here. I don't want this to be an expansive thought. But just for now, Clyde Edwards-Helaire, 10 rushing yards, 10 rushing attempts for 40 yards, 3 catches for 40 yards, 11 fantasy points yesterday. I keep saying, like, I mean, how panicked are we now on Clyde Edwards-Helaire?
I'm not yet. I get it, but I believe the touchdowns are coming. Like, he's still the main running back on one of the best offenses in football. I'm hanging tight and actually trying to acquire him low.
Okay, that's interesting.
I understand. Listen, he's not a powerful guy. He's not gonna win like sort of those goal line battles here. But like, whatever. Like, Eric Fisch has a touchdown for them. Anthony Sherman has a touchdown for them. Patrick Mahomes has 3 rushing touchdowns for them. I guess I just don't see that continuing all season long. It feels like you do.
Maybe I put it this way. Is he the most disappointing first-round pick that hasn't been injured?
That hasn't been injured.
Because, I mean,
that's a good
hold
caveat.
Yeah.
I understand a lot. Saquon and Christian McCaffrey and Mike Thomas have been injured. But, like,
yeah.
Besides that.
Yeah, and now maybe Dalvin Cook. Yeah, potentially. Yes, definitely.
He's but the most so panic meter is, I'd say, 4 for me. 1 to 4. 10 being the worst. Zach Ertz.
I don't mind a panic level of 4, but yeah. I'm still holding
tight. You got to hang tight here. Zach Ertz, 1 catch for 6 yards yesterday. 1 to 10, Matthew. 10 being the most panicked.
7.5.
Yeah, I'm at least there. I mean, the problem is that I think this is – I really believe this because I am a staunch believer in
Zach Ertz. The Steelers are a very good defense.
And I really believe and I understand that Travis Fulgham was great yesterday. We'll talk about him more on the show, but tomorrow. But – no DeSean Jackson, no Alshon Jeffrey.
No Dallas Goedert.
There was a clip, remember back in the day, Bill Belichick and Chad Ochocinco before a preseason game, and Ocho, it's a very funny clip. Bill said, hey, just so you know, we got this coverage. It's called 1-double-85. And the play is every play, we're going to double cover you, 85, right? I think that's what's happening right now is with opposing teams. Yeah. It's like they say, you know what? You want to beat us with Travis Fulgham and Greg Ward? We'll take our chances. Now, it didn't really work for the Steelers yesterday, but you just cover the heck out of Zach Ertz. 2 bodies, 3 bodies. The Alshon Jeffrey and DeSean Jackson returns and Dallas Goedert eventual returns are the beacons of hope for me with Zach Ertz. But it's a 6 right now.
Yeah. It's certainly a concern. I just don't know that you have an option. Like, unless there's somebody great on your waiver wire on your bench, like, you're probably just going to continue to have to roll him out there and hope for the best.
I would agree. That's a hard part, is that, like, it's rare to find a tight end who you can count on being better than Zach Ertz on the waiver wire.
The potential to be better than Zach Ertz.
Yeah. Last one here, Tyler Lockett. 4 catches, 44 yards yesterday. Matthew, back-to-back games, just not quite. Well, this is what Tyler Lockett does, right?
Yeah, it is. And by the way, I was the only ranker this week to have DK Metcalf over Tyler Lockett. I didn't understand. 100% I'm back. You betcha. Because I didn't understand that one. I didn't understand how I was alone on that island. Like, I saw somebody say this on Twitter yesterday. I apologize, but I 100% agree with it. Like, if you were doing a dynasty draft today, you know, a dynasty startup draft, DK Metcalf should be your number one wide receiver. Number one wide receiver in a dynasty startup draft. He's 22.
Yeah, it's. I hadn't thought of it, and I would say my initial instinct is it's not crazy.
I mean,
CeeDee Lamb might give you a run for your money. I mean, he's special too.
I agree with you. Yeah. He's in that conversation, but like, DK Metcalf is 22 and probably has at least 6 more years of playing with Russell Wilson.
That's a great, great point. I don't have a great counter. I don't have a great counter right now, so it's hard for me to begrudge that opinion.
DK Metcalf is a special dude, man.
Yeah, he sure is. He sure is. DK Metcalf was ridiculous again.
But I just think in terms of Tyler Lockett, obviously it's a disappointing game, but it's such a good passing offense. It's such a narrow target tree. I think you have to continue to keep him out there. I will say, if you're in a deeper league and you're looking for just sort of like, as we talked about, running back insurance, if anything were to ever happen to DK Metcalf or Tyler Lockett, I've seen this point made as well, and I forget who, so apologize. But David Moore is somebody that would be really interesting.
Yeah,
I mean, he's a talented player. We've talked about him over the years multiple times. He was out there, you know, he's basically the number 3, and, you know.
I feel like every catch that David Moore makes is a really, really nice catch.
Yes,
the dude's got some special footwork, and Russell Wilson puts balls on a absolute dot in a line for the Seahawks. All right, we got a bunch of stuff to get to tomorrow. We'll have a recap of Monday Night Football and, of course, any sort of updates pertaining to Tuesday Night Football. But as of right now, we are all full steam ahead for Titans and Bills being played on Tuesday night. Please make sure, if you're listening to this either live or before 1:45 p.m. Eastern time, to go check out Stefania Bell on Outside the Lines. For Matthew, I think you have a new fantasy show coming out?
Yeah, it comes out tomorrow morning. First thing tomorrow morning on ESPN+. And by the way, if you subscribe to ESPN+, you'll also be able to watch Project 11 with Stefania Bell on demand. Congratulations to Alex and his family. Congratulations to my world champion, L.A. Lakers. That's right. Thank you, Jeannie Buss. And LeBron and AD and everyone. AC Fresh.
Get some socks.
You know what? When you're a champ, you can wear whatever socks you want.
Wow.
Stefania
Bell. Or you can go shirtless like J.R. Smith. We're back on Tuesday with waivers and so much more. We'll talk to you then.
Peace out!